a secret allied base deep in enemy territory.
So this place not only has a history of the guerrilla camp, but also as a waypoint for people escaping capture.
The notorious haunted asylum that enforced brutal treatment on a terrifying scale. Surgeons would literally go into the brain and experiment with damaging or severing certain parts of the brain. The subterranean home of a secret society with an American founding father amongst its ranks.
This is a strange, spooky place, but it has an incredible history of glamour, celebrity, scandal, and debauchery.
Decaying relics, ruins of lost worlds, forged through years of toil, now haunted by the past, their secrets waiting to be revealed. On the Balkan Peninsula of Europe is what's known as the Land of the Eagle. Deep in the hills of southern Albania are the dramatic remnants of a secretive history.
Albania is a mountainous and somewhat beautiful and desolate region. This is a mysterious place. For much of the last century, it was hidden away behind closed doors, isolated, and it retains a certain mystique even today.
There's still a lot of things to be explored in this area. A lot of secrets to be uncovered from those decades.
This isolation was born out of a conflict that touched every corner of Europe. Clinging to the hillside, overlooking the Bay of Flora, is a relic of this troubled time.
This village produced 45 of what Albanians called martyrs, heroes of World War II. This tiny village has a phenomenal tale to tell.
A few miles away is a mysterious cave linked to this village and connected to a remarkable escape story.
That is a machine gun tripod. That's the smoking gun. This is their guerrilla home. This is their cathedral.
But what were British and American secret agents doing in this remote backwater?
This is a classic World War II story. You've got spies, resistance, smugglers, heroes, villains. This has got it all.
This humble-looking settlement would play a key role in secret operations led by British SOE and American OSS agents during World War II. They chose this village as a base from which to wage a guerrilla war. Ex-Special Forces operative Clint Janulis wants to understand why.
I served in Iraq in the Special Forces, and the U.S. Special Forces are guerrilla warfare specialists. I'm here to understand why the precursors to the modern Spec Ops units decided to choose this abandoned, destroyed village as a base of operations, because it was those groups like the OSS and SOE that basically wrote the playbook on guerrilla warfare that we still use today.
Set up during the war, these organizations coordinated espionage activities behind enemy lines. But to take a closer look at this former base in such rugged terrain requires some serious wheels.
Driving up here, I was trying to put myself in the position of an attacking soldier, and I realized just how terrifying that would be, because getting up here, you see the fortified positions. Oh, wow. This place looks like it was designed to be a fortress. This is a sniper point. You could even have small artillery pieces up here and be protected and secure. And you have a view of the entire valley from this exact location. This is where I would want to fight a guerrilla battle against an invading force down that valley.
Before
broke out, when dictator Benito Mussolini caught the world by surprise, targeting the main ports, including Flora Bay, which sits just beneath Trejas.
Mussolini was looking at expanding this Italian empire. Albania was an easy grab for the Italians. Mussolini wanted this piece of territory that was just across the Adriatic from Italy.
When Mussolini's forces crossed Albania's southern border into Greece, Great Britain stepped in and began targeting Italian ships in the region. In March 1941, a 135-meter-long hull became the victim of a raid by torpedo bombers.
In the darkness, and with its lights off, the British airmen believed this was a legitimate wartime target. They had no idea what this ship actually was and who was on board.
The Poe was, in fact, a hospital ship, evacuating wounded Italian soldiers from the Greek-Albanian front.
By coincidence, one of the nurses aboard this hospital ship was Mussolini's own daughter.
Anna Ciano, Mussolini's daughter, survived, but the sinking was part of a campaign that was soon escalating out of Italy's control.
The Italians are losing on every front. Equipment, leadership, morale is breaking down. They're trying to maintain their control of key areas, and certainly the coastal region in Albania is considered by the Italians as a key area.
The Albanian resistance sensed an opportunity, and Trejas became both a base and supply point for local guerrillas taking the fight to the Italians.
The guerrillas decide to make a fight of it, and in this case, they do very, very well, and they cause very heavy casualties, because in this terrain, it's ideally suited for guerrilla-style defense.
Clint has returned to Trejas to investigate why it became a focal point of this resistance movement.
Essentially, I'm making a sort of logistical reconnaissance of this village. The tactical advantages of this village are pretty obvious right away. Thick walls, rough terrain, good strong buildings. But really what I'm interested in is the logistics. Armies win and lose based on logistics. In the logistics war, water is crucial. And this isn't just a well, this is a natural spring, which means hydrostatic pressure is pushing water out. They've got water year-round. Anybody attacking from up the hill, they'd have to haul their water up. Now, yeah, this is cool. This reminds me a lot of Greek villages I've been in that were designed to be windy and mazy, basically to defend against pirates, which meant anybody that was trying to come in and attack by foot would get run through corridors and mazes and funnel points, which we call funnels of death.
With these advantages, guerrillas were making life for Italy's occupying forces a nightmare, picking off troops and harassing infantry columns with hit-and-run raids. Soon, the constant skirmishing came to a head as Italian Colonel Franco Clemente brought in a division to reestablish control of Trejas and four other villages in the area.
On New Year's Day, 1943, there was a massive pitched battle where 2,000 very well-equipped Italians were beaten by the local Albanian guerrilla forces. This David versus Goliath battle ended in victory for the Albanians.
Despite bolstering his numbers to well over 5,000 men, outnumbering the Albanians 3-1, Colonel Clemente was killed, and his forces suffered a humiliating defeat. But repercussions soon followed for Trejas. Mussolini's forces returned to take their revenge, this time on civilians.
But after Battle Bussola, Italians came here first, and it is said they even hit the village with mortar fire from the mountain peak of Chaput, above the village of Oricum. Then,
burned the village. They alienated the villagers even further.
Despite these reprisals, the Italian presence was disintegrating. So the Allies sent covert units to support these local resistance fighters against Mussolini's crumbling occupation. But also the Nazis who were closing in on Albania. British agent Jerry Field based his team here in Trecase.
Jerry Field was this very daring operative for the SOE. And he came in with a small group of men and initially set up shop right in Trecase and worked with the local partisans, relayed information back to the British, trying to supply local partisans who were fighting the Nazis, and basically trying to figure out how to do as much damage to the Germans as possible.
His principal task was to smuggle arms in from Italy, which had now been invaded by the Allies. Once the Americans and British land in 1943 and occupy southern Italy, it's only a very short hop from a major Italian port like Bari across the Adriatic into Albania. It's very easy to supply guerrillas by boat. Yet Clint has discovered that British secret agents suddenly abandoned Trecase. He's been given coordinates for a location that will help him understand why. Even today, it's really hard to find. It's not on the map, and most locals don't know where it is or that it even exists. I didn't expect to find this, and this tells quite a lot, because this is a British machine gun mount. And it says right here, Mark 4, 1942, and then you'd have the ability to mount a really heavy machine gun on this, and anybody coming up that hill would have faced a barrage of gunfire. But also, this thing is heavy. I've carried machine gun mounts before. We can't be too far from the cave. We're getting close. Okay. This isn't just a rock overhang. This goes really deep. Oh, this has got to be the place. That is a machine gun tripod. That's the smoking gun. This is their guerrilla home. This is their cathedral.
But how is this cave linked to a remarkable American escape story? And who brought their wrath on Trecase? Discovered a secret cave used by British agents during World War II.
Just looking at this makes me really think. Yeah, it's a great guerrilla hideout, but this is potentially a really horrible death trap. A couple hand grenades thrown down in here, and look at all these. These are going to just, you'll just die under a mass of stalactites. And that is something I'm sure they thought about constantly. It could have just even been as simple as a bomb landing just overhead the cave. Imagine being right here. 500-pound bomb lands.
Agent Field led his team down from the mountains above Trecase to this Sea View Cave. A perfectly camouflaged hideaway near a Dog Lake Cove used to smuggle arms and supplies into Albania. For months on end, Field and his team survived here on mule meat and rainwater.
I can't imagine how surreal it would have been to live here every day and then go fight, pick up illicit supplies from the coast, go sabotage the enemy, and then come back to this and have a meal of a hot mule.
Forced out of Trecase in September 1943, when the Nazis rolled into Albania, they now had to coordinate resistance from this extraordinary cave. But it would soon prove more than just a secret base, playing a key role in an incredible escape story. one plane that was carrying 13 American nurses ran low on fuel and got lost in bad weather. They crash landed in a field in the middle of Albania in the middle of winter.
Trapped in Nazi-occupied territory with no food or supplies, local partisans smuggled them out of the Albanian interior across the snowy mountains towards the coast.
They had to dodge German patrols. At one point, they got caught up when the Germans were invading a particular town and the group got split up, but they all survived and were able to keep moving on.
Eventually connecting with the SOE, they brought the nurses to this cave. And Clint, himself a combat medic, believes he may have found evidence of their stay here.
This is World War II. Medical gauze. It looks just like the medical gauze we use today. From a med kit. From 76 years ago. Huh. You can even see the cotton stitching in it still. That's pretty cool.
The following day, agents led the nurses to their secret cove, where an American boat was waiting to extract them to Allied-controlled Italy.
So after walking hundreds of miles in the middle of winter through some of the roughest terrain I can imagine, the nurses managed to hook up with the SOE, who were fortunate enough to be able to arrange transportation that day. So they came down this crazy ravine and valley that I just walked, and the first thing they see is this gorgeous Smuggler's Cove, and that's their ticket home.
So in the end, they wound up traveling between 600 and 800 miles on this incredible survival escape march. It's one of the great survival stories of World War II.
But while the nurses were heading home, the villagers and partisans were left in a war zone. This was home. There was no escape. Clint wants to find out what happened to them after Field's unit left Trejas.
How did the Nazis respond when they found out about the heavy resistance movement going on right here in this village?
The unit they came in and they burned. They ruined everything. You can see only ruins remain here. That's why the population abandoned the village and resettled elsewhere. They were left with nothing here but bare walls and ruins.
The Germans decided to raise this village to the ground, while the British and American agents that had been working with the villagers were sitting on these hillsides, watching as this group that they had known, cared about, lost every single thing they had in one fell swoop.
The Nazis left the settlement engulfed in flames. Sovo explains how this spurred his family to take action.
My eldest uncle joined the partisans, the 5th Brigade. He even went with them to fight the Germans up to Yugoslavia.
I really loved hearing Sofa's story because it reminds me that in little tiny villages all over Europe, just like this one, everyday people had to make decisions about whether or not they were going to resist and fight. There was working with the SOE and the Office of Strategic Services, and doing so at great risk to their family's life, their lives, and their community's lives.
Today, a memorial to the partisans stands amongst the rubble, a monument to their brave resistance against fascist invaders. In the heart of West Virginia, on the banks of the Fork River, sits an enormous structure with a horrifying story to tell.
It's an incredibly imposing building, like something from the colonial era. It looks like it was laid out for some vast civic purpose. And there's a whole lot of other buildings around it, almost like it's some kind of a college campus. You can see that it was a major project in its day.
Inside are clues that paint a confusing picture of this strange site's purpose.
There's something of an eerie about the juxtaposition between the children's toys and the serious medical instruments
When you look inside, it's a mess. I mean, clearly, it's abandoned, neglected. There's peeling paint. There's bars over some windows and doors. It has a forbidding quality.
This was clearly a site designed to contain, but not for those convicted of a crime.
This place emerged out of an enlightened view. It was meant to be a haven for people who were cast out from the world.
Well, what started as a really noble experiment quickly degenerated into a real horror show of abuse.
What turned this dream into a nightmare? And who were the inhabitants that were forced to call this place home? Construction here began in the mid-1800s. In time, the halls would witness atrocities that left their mark on the building and the surrounding community. Its purpose was the management of the clinically insane. And nearly two centuries ago, mental illness was viewed with disturbing suspicion. Those exhibiting its signs were considered to be possessed by demons.
The treatment of mental health back in the early 19th century was almost worse than a death sentence. Families with members who had mental health problems often hid them away. Those who weren't lucky enough to be able to do that had their relatives simply carted off and locked up. Mental health was never really understood. There were a lot of supernatural explanations. I mean, even the word lunatic comes from the idea that it was somehow inspired by the moon.
But one forward-thinking doctor would stand as a beacon of hope. His name was Dr. Thomas Kirkbride.
Dr. Kirkbride was one of those rare reformers. He saw a new way, a new world in which people could be treated and cared for and cured. And key to that was the provision of a healthy, open, normal environment. This place was going to be his masterpiece.
This is the Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum.
In the mid-19th century, ideas about mental illness were finally changing. And the asylum was designed as a place for the most progressive, scientific, and humane treatment of the mentally ill.
Kirkbride wanted to move away from the prevailing model in which the mentally ill might be chained in city jails. And so instead, one of the main buildings is this huge structure that was designed so that sunlight and air could easily come in, as opposed to sort of damp, dank cells.
Originally intended to house 250 people, patients were given the freedom to walk the long, bright corridors and enjoy the lovingly manicured grounds. But before long, Kirkbride's idealistic vision would be twisted beyond all recognition.
The understanding of mental illness was still very much in its infancy. Patients were being referred with conditions like fits or superstition or loss of limbs or even asthma.
This is a time period in which women who behave in unconventional ways could be deemed insane and sent away. A whole range of people who did not necessarily conform to societal expectations might be considered as having a nervous condition that required treatment.
At its height, the asylum was overrun with 2,600 patients, over 10 times its capacity. As the number increased, so did the depths of depravity. As Rebecca Gleason, who manages the site, has discovered.
Unfortunately, because of all the different people who were coming in and not able to leave, they weren't getting fixed. It became like warehousing.
Not only did such overcrowding lead to people sleeping on the floors, but it completely worked against the therapeutic atmosphere that the asylum was meant to engender.
sane inmates from nearby prisons.
We have to remember that there are so many different types of patients that were here. You've got mentally challenged patients. You've got someone suffering from depression, bipolar disorder, major depression, schizophrenia, all different types of aspects of mental illness. And then you have the criminal predator that was added to the situation as well.
It sounds like it became a hellish place to be. There were actually murders, there were assaults, and I can imagine just an atmosphere of fear all the time.
But the extreme violence and terrible conditions were just the tip of the iceberg.
Understanding of the brain and mental disorders was still very rudimentary, and treatments were experimental, but often brutal. And in the 1950s, the treatments would become even more grotesque when the center became the home of the West Virginia Lobotomy Project.
The man behind it was a doctor named Walter Freeman, also known as the father of lobotomy.
To perform an ice pick lobotomy, they would take this long, sharp piece and they would point it towards the corner of your eye. They would ding it once to break through your skull, and the second time to basically get into your prefrontal lobe. And they go back and forth, something like a windshield wiper does in your vehicle.
The belief was that patients who suffered from obsessive behaviors had fixed circuits in their brains. Surgeons would sweep the rods from side to side and physically cut the connections.
A barbaric practice to modern eyes. Back then, even the relative of a U.S. president would have the procedure. But how would it end? At the Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum in West Virginia, gruesome lobotomies were once the chosen treatment for its inmates. Considered cutting edge at the time, even the sister of former American President JFK endured this treatment.
Rosemary Kennedy had her operation by Freeman and she was lobotomized. She ended up spending the rest of her life, 50 plus years, in the mental hospital, only being able to mumble a couple words and not anything comprehensively.
Had this procedure not been done to her brain, she might not necessarily have had to have been institutionalized.
It just left many of these patients a shell of their former selves. They sat around passively, so maybe they weren't raging, you know, in hallucinations. They also weren't anything like a healthy person with an intact mind.
How any surgeon, let alone a brain surgeon, could have thought that sticking a metal rod through the eye and rummaging it around in the brain indiscriminately was helpful is beyond belief.
For many of the patients that entered this asylum, most would never leave. The only area that was ever expanded to accommodate the people was the graveyard.
We're in our morgue. Unfortunately, thousands of people died at the asylum over the last 130 years. God is free. There basically two bodies would lay in there and be able to stay cool. Now, at one point in time, the walls were lined with these refrigerators.
But in 1994, its doors were finally closed. The years of neglect having finally taken their toll.
You can only imagine how horrified Dr. Kirkbride would have been if he'd seen what became of his visionary asylum that he had so many hopes for, and it turned into really such a hellhole that didn't help patients and in many cases made them worse.
Today, the hospital still lies abandoned as a disturbing reminder of the pain and suffering contained 30 miles west of London, is a scene typical of the English countryside. But here, set amongst the rolling hills, is an opening to a subterranean world.
There's this incredible Gothic entrance, but then when you enter, you go deeper underground, and you end up in these sinister-looking caves.
Dark chambers with heavy metal gates, almost like cells, are hidden away. This is a strange, spooky place, but yet it has this incredible history of glamour and celebrities and dignitaries, but above all, debauchery.
What stories would make these caves infamous? And how would one of America's founding fathers become embroiled in the controversy? The origins of these subterranean passageways date to the mid-1700s. Concealed within are tales of pagan ritual, the dark arts, and scandalous depravity. Jack Orr is a historian at the site.
These caves are a quarter of a mile underground, and the thing that's so incredible about it is that it's not at all natural in any way. It's completely 100% man-made, which 250 years ago, that's just an incredible feat of human engineering.
The elaborate network excavated to provide the chalk that would help to build the Great West Road to link this area and London.
What these caves became is actually shocking. It sounds like the thing of myth and legend, but this is real life.
So we're about to go into the heart of the caves, and this is where the very mundane story becomes slightly more macabre.
These are the Hellfire Caves, home to one of the most secretive societies in British history.
The Hellfire Club was made up of some of the most famous and respected men of the age. At its forefront was the owner of the caves, Sir Francis Dashwood.
Sir Francis Dashwood was a rather wealthy man. He was born into landed gentry. And just like other men of his status at that time, he spent his final years of education visiting the royal courts of Europe, sampling the intellectual arts and all of the treasures that the continent had to offer.
It was in Italy that he found his true passion, and it was here that Sir Francis Dashwood began to revel in the study of the forbidden arts, particularly the Eleusinian Mysteries, which were the most famous secret ancient Greek initiation cult.
Inspired by what he had learned, Dashwood returned home and set up the exclusive club on his family estate. What happened inside was shrouded in mystery. Outside London are the Hellfire Caves, once home to a secret society.
There were lots of rumors of nefarious deeds. It was whispered that men practiced all manner of black magic and satanic rites in these caves.
It wasn't just dark satanic worship that the members liked to do. They also knew how to party.
Women were brought in from London to join the frolics dressed as nuns, and comely local nymphs were hired and allegedly laid out on altars so men could lick holy wine from their navels.
In the Hellfire Club's days, there would have been curtains across beds inside this chamber. If you look at the back wall, we still have the original tally marks from where the men were keeping score when they took their prostitutes.
today. In time, that would include one of the most influential figures of the fledgling United States.
Some of the members of the Hellfire Club were very famous, but one of the most famous members was William Hogarth, the artist, and some of his art is actually down our caves. But the odd thing is the most devilish figure who matched Dashwood in debauchery was actually an American.
Benjamin Franklin, one of the founding fathers of the United States, was a good friend of the Dashwoods. And he would frequently visit the UK, and when he did, he would attend these scandalous parties deep underground.
Franklin loved the fun, prankish nature of the club that he found here. He often wrote home to his friends in Philadelphia about Dashwood and his friends. One of the letters even said, Dashwood's genius is just as apparent above the earth as it is below the earth.
With much to lose, the powerful men went to great lengths to make certain word of their nefarious activities stayed hidden.
To try and protect their reputations, members of the Hellfire Club took assumed identities. Your reputation was everything in those days. You say the wrong thing, and you're out. And devil worshipping, keeping anything about black magic, any of those sort of books, that was still illegal, that was still a crime. Much of what happened there is unknown, and a lot of the documentation has been burnt or destroyed in order to cover up the scandal.
Yet, even though the members of the Hellfire Club were sworn to secrecy, word soon got out.
It seems the antics of the Hellfire Club were somehow leaked to the public. Rumor has it that it was an old member of the club that exposed it for what it really was.
The public outrage took its toll, so in 1766 the club was closed down.
With the doors to this sordid den of depravity now closed, Dashwood was said to have lived a more wholesome life until his death in 1781.
This incredible flint structure is another creation of Dashwood. It's the mausoleum for his family, but like everything, there is a darker side to this creation.
Dashwood and his four wives were all buried here, but strangely, so was one other member of the Hellfire Club.
There used to be an urn in the middle of this mausoleum, and in that urn was the heart of Paul Whitehead, and he was a former poet and head steward of the Hellfire Club.
Paul's heart laid here peacefully for nearly a century, until the Victorian era.
Now, the Victorians were weird. They loved death, they loved gore, so they made this a tourist attraction. It's rumored that his heart was stolen by Australian visitors around 100 years ago, and ever since, people say they've seen him wandering the caves and the hills, holding the place where his heart should have been, looking for it in the grounds.
Today, the Hellfire Caves are still open to the public. And for those wanting to channel the spirit of Dashwood, they can even be hired for private parties.
Because of the dark debaucherous history of the Hellfire Club, they've left this lingering legacy behind, and now we